Hello, amazing people. Hope you have an amazing day. We're gonna go live today with my sis. And she's coming on soon. And I'm not telling you who it is. I'm just waiting. And waving to people. Yes, we're going live with Abby. And it's our first time live. Let's see how it works live. Accept. Yay!
Hi. Hola, hola, hola. Hello. It is so good to see you. I just want to hug you. I'm like, I want to go through the...
It felt like such a communication already because 2 weeks ago I asked you to go live and I just felt this call to go live with you. Mm-hmm. But this week I felt like, oh, should I prepare something? And the instruction was, no, it's not needed. You just have to show up and surrender. And it's really new for me. Yeah, thank you for being here. And yeah, let's unravel some beautiful, juicy stuff.
I'm so excited. Honestly, the moment that you sent out that invitation, I was just like, yeah, anything she wants. Like, seriously, what do you want to talk about? I was like, you want to talk about the weather? You want to talk about... It doesn't matter.
Yeah, it's amazing. Like we didn't even met in real time, but with some people, you just feel this soul connection and you don't need a lot of words to just understand each other. And I have that with you. So I'm really, you know, happy that we can connect this way. So, yeah.
Nice. Thank you again,
I was
Jessica.
Just really curious about the energy that we are now experiencing, you know, as a collective, because before, you know, preparing this live for a bit, I was looking at your page and you come up with these amazing transmissions. But I also feel like as empaths, we are really easy to tune into collective energy. So is there a certain theme that is now, you know, really happening?
You know, I've been sitting with several of them, and with my closest group of friends, I've actually been going in depth about certain themes that I have seen, at least in my personal field. And I think it's important for us to understand that when we are talking about collective energies, it is just a shared sentiment. It is a magnetizing point of the people that you surround yourself with, right? And there is no right or wrong necessarily when it comes to these spaces, but rather, what are you aligned to? And coming to that understanding. The moment that you understand what your inner frequency is actually aligned to, it magnetizes those that are on similar frequencies. Therefore, we kind of get this concept or idea of a soul family, soul group that is sort of navigating through very similar lessons and classrooms of the soul, right? And they get to experience and kind of assist one another through it. In the particular space that I am in right now, it is coming into a state of surrender. Coming into a form of pause and reset and sort of witnessing everything that you have built up to this point, everything that you have journeyed through up to this point, and sort of taking stock of what you have been up to. Is it genuinely aligned with that particular soul's calling, right? That desire, that heart's pull in towards something that is genuinely nourishing, that is bountiful, that is actually going to assist you. Consistently, that is safe, you know what I mean? Nothing that is necessarily tumultuous, right? And then being in that space, witnessing the people that are around you, you know, are they actually pouring into you, or are these just repetitive loops based off of bonds that you created when you were in the space of trauma and hurt, right? I feel that there is also a lot of call for certain individuals, a lot of individuals actually, to sort of sit with themselves and be like, what am I doing here?
Yeah, for real.
What is happening here?
that's such a beautiful question to self-inquiry, because we're starting to see that the systems, you know, in this world and the institutions, they're really based on an old way of thinking, which 100%. Is now kind of being dismantled. But, you know, like Gandhi said, it's really cliche, but if you really want to change the world, it starts with you. So we cannot escape that anymore. And sometimes it's quite painful as well to get into a certain awareness of yourself. So it also takes a lot of grieving, I think, with that process.
I agree with you. And I believe that the reason why it creates so much grief and pain is because of the formulated attachments that we have created around this particular narrative that we thought we were, right? So understanding that versions of you create universes in every single stage of life, right? So we have childhood and various stages of childhood. We have our young adult years, our adulthood, and so on and so on and so on, right? Each iteration of that creates aspects of a universe that then you navigate through. These are foundational bases of which your homes, right, are being built. And so as we are shedding and dissolving these timelines, you know, then you are sort of invited into a space of not only dissolving aspects of yourself, but also dissolving all of the different things that are attached to that, you know?
Mouse is there, right? Your dog, what's your name?
His name is Miles. He's always Miles. With me, and so he wanted to hang out in the room today with me.
That's good. And he also traveled with you. I saw you were traveling with
him. This is seriously just like... he's looking out my window. He's looking out my window and just, you know, barking at whoever's outside.
Yeah. Sweet.
Yeah.
And so, you know, the grieving aspect. Is there a way, because right now I feel like we are looking more at ourselves and integrating a sort of healthy feminine and healthy masculine, but is there a certain way that we can look at to bring more balance and harmony with these energies within us? I don't know if that makes sense, my question, but
it does. I'm so glad that you brought it up, you know. And this is what I love about our dynamic. We can kind of go off in a variety of ways, right? I love it. Within each and every single one of us, we are comprised of masculine and feminine energy. And it is important for us to recognize this because I feel that oftentimes, unconsciously, we navigate one more than the other, right? I know for myself, for a very long time, I navigated under a very rigid masculine construct. It was the woman that was very business driven, was very hyper focused on only building out in the material spaces. But I had abandoned a lot of my heart. I had abandoned, you know, aspects of my sensuality. I had abandoned aspects of my creativity and expression and voice and all of these things that come with the beauty and excitement and wildness of the sacred feminine, right? And when this whole awakening journey began for me fully, I was in early 2020. And during that space, I was coming off of a very traumatic experience of wanting to take my life and ending a 15-year marriage and sort of moving out on my own and having these awakenings and dark night of the souls, and everything was happening at the same exact time. And so my masculine, wounded masculine self stepped in and said, okay, you got to do this, and you got to do that, and you got to go, and you got to move, and you got to... And my feminine was like, no. You're going to rest, and you're going to relax, and you're going to take time for yourself, and you're going to take it easy, right? And so the journey of coming into balance of both of these energies, it was truly the act of self-love and compassion, gentleness, understanding that both of them are meant to dance. That it's okay if there are moments and aspects of my journey where I am more feminine, where I want to lavish in life and really savor aspects of this journey. And then there's going to be moments of action, you know, where my masculine, my healthy masculine comes in and says, you know what, my love, I'm going to take over. And I do witness these energies as individuals that are coming together as one, you know, my sacred masculine energy, right? That healthy masculine energy of mine courts me consistently. You know what I mean? And invites me into spaces where my feminine feels safe. And that's where my creativity is birthed. Because then I'm dancing and I'm moving and I'm creating programs and I'm connecting from the heart with individuals and not from the logical constructs of the mind that are very rigid and controlling and micromanaging. You know, so allowing ourselves as a collective to understand the collective energy within ourselves first. Yeah. It's imperative. You know, we talk about the shift of happening in the collective, but the internal shift of your collective cells are truly what are being impacted, And therefore, it externalizes into your known collective.
Yeah.
Right?
And it's beautiful to witness how it first starts with you. And the path can feel really lonely because it's almost like things are being stripped away from you and you have no idea what's happening. But then on the other side, it's like, what the fuck is happening? But on the other side of the roller coaster, there is more light and there's more truth and more calmness. And also what I've experienced myself is that I really found my tribe here. And I, you know, it was a total shift. I found them here, whereas before it was totally like on my own and easy to be in this kind of like solo journey. And then the people come. And I feel like, I think what we said before, now is really the time for that as well, to gather more in real life or even online and to create these safe spaces for each other to just be in.
100%. Yeah. I mean, for you, Jessica, what have you witnessed as far as that is concerned? Because I know those of us that are called into spaces of assisting more of the feminine collective, right? And that can be genderless, but for the most part, a lot of women obviously resonate with that. How has it been for you navigating into those spaces of creating that kind of balance and union within self?
For myself, what I see is that I have to take up more space for myself. And also what I noticed in my journey, I had to come clean with a lot of codependency stuff as well that came up. And really seeing, you know, also seeing the soul contracts in my life and really being honest with myself, like I can love people, but I can also be in a state that I have to let them go and have certain boundaries for myself. Because, 100%. Yeah, we are not here to keep on looping and do things over and over again. I mean, so also realizing that. So really, for me, it was really about this codependency and have a lot of compassion for the masculine as well with that. Because for the last year, we see this, you know, feminism. But I don't think we are meant to like hate on men. We are meant to do it together and heal together. So for now, I would say I'm doing it by myself. It's like my inner union, with the intention that sooner or later it's going to be outward union with someone I'm journeying with. But a lot of undoing the codependency stuff. Yeah, that was really a big theme for me.
That's beautiful. I think that when we come into that space where we this is something I've been navigating through, right? The mask that we wear, right? There is a mask that I saw within myself wearing in front of my family. Then there was a mask I was wearing in front of friends. Then there was a mask that I was wearing in front of the spiritual group and a mask that I was wearing in front of this group and that group and whatever. And I found that there were certain connections where even if I wore a mask, they could see right through my soul.
Yeah.
They penetrated into the depths of it. And I just felt not only no need to sort of pretend or sort of filter out aspects of myself, but that they created a safety container where truth was not only invited, it was accepted and without judgment. And so I started to sit with that because I'm like, why am I surrounding myself with people where I feel like I have to modify aspects of myself and sort of release the components of vulnerable, authentic truth? You know, and then coming into the deepest spaces of self-love where I understood that who I am is actually amazing and whoever wants to journey with me, great. And whoever doesn't, that's great too. And I can release all these judgments that I hold towards other people, but especially for myself. Anytime that we judge someone else, anytime that we point the finger, we're pointing it at ourselves. It is my core belief that as I look into your eyes, Jessica, I am actually looking at myself. When I am speaking to you and feeling into your heart, I'm feeling into my own. You know, when I embrace you in this way energetically, it's just my energy coming back home into the oneness of self, right? And so what is there to judge outside of the spaces that feel very uncomfortable to me?
Yeah.
Right? So, yeah, navigating through that, you know, it allowed me the space to look at the collective, if we want to call it that, as people, as just a soul unit. It is one soul, one heartbeat, one thing, one living, breathing thing. So there was no separateness in that. you know, and if I've come into a deep understanding of God's love, then all I can see is God's love in everyone, no matter who they are and what they're, you know, whatever it is that they're navigating through.
Yeah, so true. And it gives such a reverence to this web of life and to also just see where everybody's at. Like, everybody is like walking. We're all walking each other home at the end of the day, you know? So, yeah.
I love that, though. I'm sorry. I hope it's okay. No, keep going. You're inspiring me, Jessica. You know, that whole saying, walking each other home, I've sat with that, too. I tend to journey in my mind a lot. I go into these, woof. If you talk to me, we'll go on for 5 hours, and you'll be like, what happened? Where
do we go? You gotta pick your vision.
I love it. Oh, my God. Stimulate me mentally, and it's over. But walking each other home, I was like, you know, all that's happening, you know, is that we are reminding ourselves of our heart. We're reminding ourselves that home has always been within. So there's nowhere to journey to outside of within, right? There's nothing to seek externally. There's nothing that we're lacking. There's nothing that's missing. Yeah. It is the collection of pieces of coming back into us, right? Which is God. I went to church last night with my parents, and that was very interesting because I hadn't stepped into a church since, God, forever. Yeah. But they were so excited, and you know what? I vibed with it. I was like, okay, let's go. And it was great. The people, so kind, so sweet and everything. But some of the stuff that they were saying, I sat with my inner judgment of that because I immediately wanted to be like, no. And I was like, wait.
Yeah.
They have their truth, and they're allowed that truth. It's okay. Yeah. If that's assisting them, let it be their truth. But it was this externalized God, and I remember how long it took me to fully comprehend that was never the case. Never. Right?
I witnessed it yesterday because I was recording a YouTube video, and suddenly I was talking about God, and I was like, whoa. I didn't, like, it was not planned.
I saw that.
There has been such a journey, you know, to be comfortable with saying the word God and not be, you know, it's my own intimate relationship. And it doesn't have to be like, how do you say, this rigid construct of what it's supposed to be. But I love that it has been my own journey with that. Because for me, I don't know if you have that too, but it was easier for me back in the day to say the universe because it was more like neutral and it didn't have, I don't know.
But that's what we were talking about earlier, right? Is the masks. What is your inner truth? And are you comfortable enough to just be that all the time? And not a lot of people are. You know, I know I'm not fully there yet. There's aspects of myself that I'm still like, you know. And I show myself a lot of grace and compassion in those spaces because it is a journey. It's not a race. I get to take this journey day by day, moment by moment, sometimes even breath by breath. There are aspects of things that I navigate through that I genuinely have to sit with myself and sort of do inventory and be like, where are we at today? Heart, soul, body, mind. You know, what is happening within self, right? And being 100% honest with myself is tough. But I feel that my feminine self has genuinely assisted in that because my feminine doesn't take any shit. She comes in and just says, be honest, speak your truth, vocalize it, express it, let it out, you know what I mean? And my masculine self creates that safety and says, you're allowed, you're permissed, you can let go, right? Layer by layer.
I saw you, you're sending me a photo, I think 2 days ago, you were in nature. And it's also, that's also part of the feminine. I feel that she's like, the feminine calls you also to nature if we need it.
Oh, yeah.
And it's such a beautiful medicine for that. So I also have been implementing that whenever I feel this call or urge. And it just makes total sense that I need to like unwind in nature and just, you know, let the thinking go and just be with her. She has been an amazing like teacher, nature. So.
Oof, yesterday was insane, in the best of ways. I took my dog for a hike, and I've been exploring this area because I'm new to it. But I found this incredible park, and literally pulling up to it, my heart was already going through a lot. And I was like, "What's going on here?" And they're like, "Oh, it's like the second oldest oak tree in the eastern whatever." And I was just like, "Wow, like that's amazing." So I definitely wanted to see it. The moment that I was like in its presence, all the mother codes just started to activate, right? And that's just, the mother self, the mother energy, the mother, was calling so deeply. And nature and I have built a relationship. We've created a romance with one another. You know what I mean? I've felt like as I've been romanced by nature in a way that I denied it years back. And I literally sat there and I was shedding tears while I was hugging this tree. And I was like, I am crying over a tree. And it was amazing. It was so dope. I was like singing, and this light language came out, and I was just in this flow, and I was just having the time of my life, So incredible. But I was there hugging this tree, and these tears are shedding, and I just sat with myself, and I'm like, you just cried over a tree, but it was beautiful.
No, it makes so much sense because I feel in ancient folklore, the oak tree is like a gateway. The shamans used it as a gateway for stories, like to transfer the stories.
Oh, and the trees were speaking. I
They're
heard
speaking.
trees speaking, and I was just like, you can hear the trees speaking over here. I'm like, that's wild. Yeah, you want to activate the feminine, go into nature. Like 100%. Dance, dance, cook. I love to cook, cook, dance, write, express. It's very rare for the feminine to be fully, in my opinion, to be fully active if you're just sitting. If you're just like in that space
Oh
of
yeah.
just sitting, she gets to be soft, but she loves to express.
Resting is very important one.
100%.
Resting without feeling guilty. Guilt can be big if you're always like you're so used to doing. You have to rest. And I feel that's such a practice because when you rest, it's like you're, or just with your eyes closed, you can just daydream and new visions come and those things.
Ever since I got to Florida, I feel like that's what I've been doing the most, actually, is just nourishing
Very
myself, being very soft, not
nice.
feeling like there's a deadline to anything, And what I meant by my statement, it was more like, have fun, you know what I mean? And listen to your body, listen to yourself. What is it that you need? If it's meditation, go there. If it's being childlike, go there. Whatever's calling to you without judgment,
Yeah, I think the more we do that, the easier it just gets to follow up on our, inspiration and our intuition. And there's less excuses. We just go and, do what feels right and, from the inspiration. Just follow it. Just as I felt this call to have you here, like have this co-creation talk, because I had no idea how it would be, but it was just like, just be there. That's all. That's all we need
I love
to
that.
do.
No, I love that so much. Honestly, when you sent that message over, first of all, very excited and honored. So thank you for that. But I felt that it was also necessary. I find that while we have been navigating a lot of the spaces of feminine culture and nature and sort of decluttering a lot of what that narrative means too, because right now we're in this kind of space, and I'll place myself in it as well, where we love to compartmentalize energy, right? And it's funny because in spirituality, supposedly we're here to break through all that. We're here to sort of break through labels and boxes and constructs and all that stuff. Being mindful of our masculine self, right? But that's also a label. But just being an observance of that. But now we're in this whole essence of, okay, everything is sacred and we're going into that space. And I'm just like, okay, it's the new trend. It's the new thing. It's the whatever that we're entering into. And I don't see anything wrong with it. But us being mindful of creating deeper division and separateness, which isn't really what supposedly we're here for, right? We're mm-hmm. here to actually unify. We're actually here to create more of that heart-centered space, that God's love essence to flow in and through, right? There's always a time and place, you know, for us to sort of nurture one another and the resonance yeah. that we're going to find in one another, right? With the things that our personal coding is asking for. So maybe I'm navigating through, right, feminine wounds, and I do need someone like you to step in and sort of activate a remembrance of what true, genuine, healthy, mm-hmm. nourishing femininity is about. But mm-hmm. there will be other moments where I'll navigate with certain friends or people that I understand have a very healthy, like, sturdy masculine energy. And I'm like, you know what? I really need your assistance. Is it devoid yeah. of gender, of course, but, you know, at the end of the day, it's everything has to serve. The balance of it all, right? Yeah. Blame it on my Libra self, because I really feel about balance, fairness, beauty.
Yeah. And so, yeah. I had one question though that I would love to ask, because you that came as a surprise. You wrote a journal,
and I did
you focused on, you know, feminine awakening. Mm-hmm. And I would love to hear more from that. How was that process for you? Like, how did it come up?
If we're going to go there. Thank you so much for asking. The Sacred Feminine Journal was something that I actually have been working on for a long time, longer than I thought I had been, to be honest with you. I had had a book, and I'm actually about almost halfway through a book that I've been writing since I was 15. Mm-hmm. And mind you, I'm far from being 15 these days. But I was sitting with this idea of writing this book, and I was sort of like, I kept putting it away, to be honest with you, because it just, certain aspects of perfectionism kept coming in, and I was like, it's not ready. So back in 2021, I began this journal, and just, it came out of the spaces of stuff that I would post on my Instagram, right? And from the containers that I would hold and the invitations that I would get for events and stuff like that. But seriously, to put it all together, to write it all together, it took about a month. And so I was sitting with all of this content and sort of sifting through, and I'm like, what makes sense? What doesn't make sense? Is this good? Is this not good? Does this resonate? Does this not? So much intention. So we navigate through 8 weeks where we are really going in depth. It's sort of like navigating through a gathering or a container, but on your own. Mm-hmm. And you get to do this by yourself, or you get to do this with some family and friends. And that's been the coolest thing. The people ordering the journals are doing it with their families. I had this mom actually order 5 of them, and they're journeying with it. Mm-hmm. Like together, and it's like, oh, it's for my sister and my daughter and whatever. And I was just like, this is so cool. And so it's literally like hearing my voice as you're reading through these pages, and it's guiding you and prompting you into different spaces of the feminine self, right? And we go into sensuality, we go into creative expression. We go in depth with the mother wound, and my mother actually helped me write that chapter, which I was so honored with. Yeah. Her and I are going to be doing like work together, but there's still stuff that we're navigating through as mother and daughter, you know, but I loved that she added, you know, to the journal as a whole, because I was able to sort of get my mother, you know, into the mother wound and be very honest about the stuff we've navigated through in our own personal relationships. It's taken a lot. And so we navigate through themes and topics like that, even financial abundance and lack and scarcity codes, limited beliefs, you know, a mindset shift for sure. And activating gifts, we go through all that kind of stuff. It's exciting. I love that journal. It's one of the things I'm most proudest of. Yeah, so.
Amazing. And also amazing, you know, you got your mother involved with it.
Yeah.
In the process.
That's been a long road with her and I.
Important thing. So important. Look at the lineages. And I see it in my family as well. I see it mostly with my mom, doing a lot of work with her. But she has a lot of like this conflict with her mother. So I'm kind of like the bridge. And I also really feel that I'm the one like breaking certain cycles. But it has been a really honorable journey to learn about the family and to ask questions. I think asking questions is a very important thing, because what we don't really know where we come from, really. Like, there's so much that we don't know. And it's important to ask, like, and see how your elders respond to you, or, you know, come up with the stories, how they were brought up. And
100%. You know, coming into a deeper relationship with my mom, her and I, by my choosing, mind you, after my awakening or journeying into the space, I stayed away from my family. You know, I had a lot of hurt, you know, that I was navigating through, and a lot of trauma and a lot of wounds. And so I really rejected my family, my parents, my brother, everyone. And I isolated myself tremendously. And so with my mother, it was painful. You know, she's been telling me a lot about that side, you know, of what she experienced on the other end. But what I found very interesting, her and I had a very codependent relationship. She depended on me for a lot of things, advice, you know, for just a friend, like all these things. And I'm like, you know, you're married. I shouldn't have to be the counselor for everything, right? You have a spouse that can be your equal and can be here in support of you. And so it really required for my dad to step up.
Yeah.
It required for him to step into a masculine role and kind of learn what that was about, right? And so it was beautiful to arrive in Florida now and sort of witness this new iteration of them and being presented with an invitation of getting to know them once more. And from the healthiness of all the work that they had put into themselves, because they had to. There was no safety net. There was no sort of like thing to fall back into. It really had to be dependent on themselves. And so navigating through the mother wound with my mother, there was a lot of discovery of her own inner child wounds of abandonment. You know, she didn't get to grow up with her own mother and father from the time that she was born. And so we have similar woundings with that. And a lot of self-doubt, self-worthiness, a lot of limited beliefs, a lot of oof. So the list goes on and on and on and on. You know, but it's really beautiful to pour into them and have them pour into me. I found that to be probably the most beautiful component of arriving here was my dad stepping into masculine energy and just being like, I'm gonna take care of this and I got that and you don't have to worry about this and you just rest and you relax. And immediately my shoulders just went, you know, and then seeing my mom being like, I want to nourish you into health and I want to pour love into you. And I was just like, who are you guys? What did you do with my parents? They've always been so kind, you know, loving people. But I mean, to witness this component of them, it was a treat.
Wow, beautiful. And such a divine time. I mean, you already felt the calling to go, but to also witness the change in them.
100%. 100%.
Beautiful. I kind of know how it feels like. I don't know if you know my story, but I lived in Bali for 3 years. In 2019, I came back because I felt this calling to go home and meet my family. Wow. But when I arrived, it was quite a trip because I started to see myself, like all my things were exposed, like all my childhood stuff just came out and I needed to witness it, but also still look from a bigger perspective that it is guided that I'm here and I'm doing the work and that's what it's about, you know. But
100%.
It's really like that's the work and it's amazing.
Oh yeah.
And not from the way, because I was easy to go live in another country and just move cities, but the work has to be here.
And it's really for those of us that have had this call to sort of come in and be cycle breakers for our family units, right? It is a very powerful responsibility to sort of step into that space. And again, same thing that we were talking about earlier, right? Sit in our authentic truth and sort of be like, there is another way. There is another way to think about this, look at this. There's different perspectives that we can step into, and life gets to be more joyful. Life does get to be more peaceful. Life does get to be more abundant. It gets to be witnessed as the blessing for what it is, instead of sitting in these like, life is just so challenging and it's hard and it's pressing and look at the news and this and that. You know, we kind of get to sit in that space as the way shower you know, as the, you know, I'm missing the word, but you get to be the light, you know, in the midst of the different components of shadows that they're navigating through, but they're the shadows that you grew up with. They're the shadows that still lay within you, unless you're willing to shine your own inner light into them, right? And you're doing this for yourself, but also for your family. And they're eventually, right, will pour that back into you. At least that's been my personal, you know, experience with that.
So much to cover here.
I can go on in that tangent too.
Maybe there are some questions. Maybe.
Oh, yeah. If anybody has any.
And something came up in their mind, in their fields.
Yeah, from us chatting away. Yeah, I honestly, I find that spaces like this are always so important because nuggets always come out. These little golden nuggets that I like to call them always comes out, and we get to sort of journey together as family, understanding that the stuff that you are going through, you're not alone. There's been so much like narrative of death and rebirth, right? Especially during eclipse season, if you're following astrology and you're kind of going through those narratives. But it's pretty undeniable, right? Just your feeling into it. You see it, you witness it in your own life. But it's paradigms that are being dismantled and sort of dissolved, necessarily so. Again, I feel that at times in spiritual communities, we get into this mindset that we are better than most and better than the other and better than the neighbor. When in reality, we're coming back into a neutrality that it's all one and it's all the same. Yeah. And it's just polarities. A phrase that I really like to say is, can you invite within your field that we live in an eternal existence where there are multiple possibilities and probabilities to everything? So how could there not be multiple truths as well? You know, it's just finding the one that resonates with you most, right? So it is really beautiful to sort of see the collective navigating through aspects of that within themselves, and then you're witnessing externally how that shift is happening. A lot of gifts being activated these days.
A lot. For me, it was like suddenly I hear my masculine just talking to me, but it's my masculine self. But I'm asking sort of questions to it, like what kind of qualities do I want to have the masculine to have? Like what kind of quality and how can I embody them? Yes. That's like, how can I embody them? So that I don't have like grasp outside, but like, how can I embrace more of my wholeness? That's kind of like the thing that came up for me.
Oh, yeah.
And it feels new. It feels like I'm able to hold more love, and it feels a bit new.
I love that though. Honestly, the romancing of the self is something that I tend to navigate through a lot. I love writing myself love letters. I love, you know, really pouring into myself. I love treating myself to things as I'm able to. But even a walk in nature is a treat, you know, and it gets to be a time where I am romanced with nature and life as a whole, and the people that I have conversations with, you know, become a part of that love letter that I write to myself daily, you know. I think that that's why, for me personally, there's been a big call into the space of honoring the sacred temple that is us, not just the sacred feminine and the energy of that, which I love, by the way. I think it's great that we're entering into that, but the temple of the soul and of the body and of the mind and of the heart, and how it is that we are actually treating this, the evidentiary proof, right, of how it is that we actually honor ourselves in a sacred way. The foods that we eat, the conversations that we have, the music that we listen to, the clothes that we wear, the people that we surround ourselves with, the way that we treat Earth and everyone around us, you know, in that same space, that creates sacredness. That's the sacred ceremony, really.
Life, you know, it's a ceremony. If you think about it, with everything can be a certain ceremony for yourself. Even if it's going through heartbreak, you know, everything can be a ceremony and a whole change of being and a whole initiation into something new. Now, I have to see, like, Shelly has a beautiful add-on. She said, spirit has been loud lately, calling everyone to look within. It's so true.
Yeah. Why wouldn't that be the call, though, always, right? Especially if what we want to impact is the external. And I find that a lot of people are sort of always in that space of, it's the mission, it's the purpose, it's the this, it's the go, it's the masculine speaking, right? And wanting to be heard, wanting to be validated and seen. And so I feel that in within ourselves, we get to sit with that call and say, can I internalize this first so that my light can shine even brighter for wherever it is that I'm being led, understanding that my sole purpose and calling is to be. People have a lot of difficulty accepting that because they're like, be what? And it's like, just be. What do you mean? Just be. Just be the I am. Just be. You know, we always want to create this sort of like, I got to go and I got to create and I got to, there's nothing wrong with any of that. But can you allow the space of centered neutrality, 0 point, be? And I think that a lot gets emitted out, a lot gets birthed from that.
First the being and then the doing.
Within. That's all within. The universe is created from within. The coding of the universe is created first within. You think that the matrix and the codes of the galactic and the cosmic and universal, you know, is so externalized. It's within. These grids we're talking about are all within. The ley lines, the meridian points, all these things within. First, we are the ones that are the creators, right? That's what we say. You're the creator. Okay, so then why wouldn't the mirroring of that be within first? Why wouldn't that be the epicenter of self, of all God's, God expression, source expression, universal expression, within, in, eyes in, within, go in, right?
Your own Google. It's really like, Google's practical, but if you really want to listen to the calling, it's within. It's going inward.
It creates too much distortion, right? And that's not to say, let's not say guidance. There's specific people that you have allowed to create this sort of soul assignment, if you want to label it something, right? That are designed particularly to assist you. And we do this for one another collectively, right? Mm-hmm. But these are the fragments of self that you're calling in. Me meeting you, Jessica, was me saying there is a component of myself that I label Jessica, and I am calling her in. And I'm saying, Jessica, come here. Jessica, let's journey. Jessica, let's learn. Jessica, let's learn and grow. Jessica, let's trigger. Jessica, let's go through hardship. Let's go through heartbreak. Let's grow in the depth and in the light and the, in, you know, in the height of it all and in the depth of it all and all the in between, right? And certain connections do that in a matter of minutes. Some come in for a month, some come in for years. Some of them, it's a quote unquote lifetime of that kind of journey, right? That's where the detachment gets to come in because you witness everyone as sort of like, this is how long we were meant to journey. Yeah. This is what we agreed to and it's okay. Like you said. Yeah, like you said, even the pain is serving.
Sorry?
It's like you said, even the pain is serving. The heartbreak is serving.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And for what would you advise to someone that is on the journey of activating their gifts, for example?
Ooh. Oof. I love this question. Thank you. I love this question. So first and foremost, allow yourself to understand that all the gifts that you can possibly, that have come into your field, right? Let's say that something's resonating with you, right? This is where the inner authority, inner truth, inner voice really steps in, the intuition of it all, right? Logic kind of has to take a step back because oftentimes logic is just going to come in to assist you, masculine, to assist you in building it out. Right? This is how it's going to look. This is what we're going to do. Da, 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 da. But the feminine says, listen, observe, receive, allow. That's a big one. Allow. So if there has been certain things that have been coming into your field and for some reason there is like a repetitiveness about it, right? For me, let's say light language, sound frequency healing, womb healing, you know, things like that. first of all, you're going to see it everywhere. You're going to hear about it everywhere. You're going to come in contact with people that are already doing it. Mm-hmm. There's going to be spaces within you where your heart just feels it. There is this, yes, you know, and you get excited about it. That inner child comes through and you get very excited about like these things, you know, that you're surrounding yourself with. Lean in, understanding that if this is something that is already in your field, it's already within. That's what we've been talking about, right? Nothing external hasn't already been placed within you. All things, that includes gifts. So when I first started this journey, I didn't have the logical, really, about spirituality. Thank God. I hadn't been in the space of let me study spirituality, let me whatever. I had a very childlike wonderment about it. I did everything. I went into, you know, Reiki and hypnosis sessions and sound baths and meditations and all this stuff. And I was like, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh my God. And in that space is where I found my voice. In that space, I allowed myself to play. I allowed myself the room to have fun and to explore and to be curious and to taste and savor. And it's okay if it's not fully meant for me, if I try it, but I get to try it. Releasing the perfectionism, releasing that whole, it has to look a particular way because they're doing it a particular way. Who said? You get to do this life and this journey, all components of it in your own expression. And it's necessary for you to do so. You cannot be a carbon copy of someone else because that's actually, what's the point of that? I love to say, there's entire roomfuls of people waiting for you, not someone else, not however so-and-so is doing it. They're waiting for however it is you're going to step in and assist in that texture. Nobody has the voice that you have. Nobody has the heart that you have. Nobody has the mind that you have. So yeah, I don't know if that answered it.
Oh, beautiful. I will have to like digest it all. No, I hear, if I can sum it up, it's really about allowing, that's the big word, of allowing it to come to you and to let it be revealed to you. Mm-hmm. And also it's, you know, to see that it has its own divine timing as well. Absolutely. I don't feel like we can always force this because it comes from the mind to always like that I figured out. But when we allow, we relax. And when we are in this relaxed state, we can allow it to come to us.
Feminine. Yeah. Feminine. The feminine opens, right? Opens itself up to all of the possibilities and says, what can I savor here? Ooh. What can I explore there? Ooh, this looks fun. Ooh, this is intriguing. This is really sparking something within me. And that internal fire, when that call comes in, when that seed gets planted, right? When we are fertilized with creativity, we are fertilized with purpose and with drive and all that stuff. Oh, it's juicy energy because honestly, our entire soul lights up in the remembrance of what we've always been. Of components of us that have done this before. It's just a coming home of self and just saying, yep, I remember her. Yep, I remember him. I remember this part of myself. Absolutely, let's go, you know?
Yeah, and I feel it's also part when you are on that track of, you know, following things through and taking action on your inspiration. But I also noticed that it's most likely that your ego will come into play and you will face your fears, but we have a choice, you know, we either stay, you know, playing safe or we look at the fears and we just go straight through it and, you know, and but I noticed that's a really big thing. If you want to reclaim your voice, for me, I used to be very afraid to even be in this online space, you know. I had certain blocks and I would see them in my relationships, how I would not have boundaries or how I could just not speak up. So I feel that's, if I look back, that really has been part of my soul journey. So in order to be where I'm at now, I had to go through these stages of, you know, being quite small and not being able to speak out. So I feel like it comes a lot of liberation from claiming your gifts as well.
That's beautiful. Yeah, you know, depending how we grew up, right? A lot of those limited beliefs and limitations that we put up for ourselves or are put in front of us and we accept and integrate, right? Play a massive role in all of it, because some of us grew up not being allowed, again, allowance, not being allowed to be in the expression of bravery, you know, or to be in the expression of creative energy, or to be in the space where we can voice out our opinion or voice out our thoughts, you know. And so now in this space, sort of sitting with that energy and saying, yes, I will. Yes, I can. Yes, I'm worthy. Yes, I'm capable. And it's okay if I'm messy about it. And it's okay if I make mistakes. And it's okay if I stumble through it. It's okay. You know, all of it is valid. All of it is permissed, you know, in the space of growth. It's all permissed. And I pray every day that I remain the student of life. And I never get to a point where I say, I know everything. I made it, you know. I think sitting in the seat of the observer is always so much fun. So much fun, you know. We enjoy the ride a lot more, you know, than feeling like we got to navigate everything all the time. You know.
Student and curiosity. Amazing. I love them. Feels right. And I love the people that are here. I'm just get excited. I sometimes I notice that I can feel the energy of the people in the space. So I'm just curious if people have something to share as well, or maybe a question.
Yeah, feel free. Feel free to chime in or ask, you know, anything that's coming into your field as you're listening to this. I know, you know, groupings like this create a lot of activation, right? And I think that activation gets seen as sort of like, you got to have this cosmic experience. No, it's just a remembrance. It's a hello from your inner self, just saying, remember, I'm right here. And you're activated into remembrance. You're activated into knowing this. So, yeah, if any of that has happened today, that would be so dope to find out.
Remembrance. Amazing. I don't have any questions anymore.
No, you're good. Honestly, as you can tell, I can. You say a word, and I'll go off of it. When I was a kid, I did talk, but I wouldn't say I spoke a lot. It was very like a filtered narrative that would come out of me. So I think that now in adulthood, I've just sort of unleashed my wildness, and I've unleashed my creativity. And I just said, you either like it or you don't. Yeah.
But that's also a thing, because sometimes we feel too much.
I'm being too much. That's a
big thing. It was kind of like a theme this week, because I had a dream. It was an amazing dream, by the way. Mm. It was about, I was traveling and I was really in my air element. So I'm basically like 80% air or something in my chart. And in my dream, I was like mastering this element, and I woke up and I realized, hey, this has been such a blessing for me, but I haven't really seen it as a blessing. Sometimes there were spaces where I didn't feel fully received with that kind of like airy, you know, airiness of me. But this week I feel like, whoa, no, you got to remember, you know, we all came with a certain, you know, makeup. And we have to come to a point where we have to kind of accept all of that, you know, that wholeness that we are in all these elements. Yes. So I don't even know why I shared this with you, but.
No, that's beautiful. And, you know, I would say as that channels through, don't even question it. There's somebody on here that I know got to listen to that, you know, had the opportunity to listen to that, because I'm sure that people navigate through that. When the elements came knocking at my door, you know, back in 2020, obviously I knew about elements. I'm in my 40s, right? But I knew about elements. But I didn't know about my chart. I didn't know about any of that stuff. And so I started to dive in, and same thing, you know, I was like, oof, I'm a Libra stellium and I got all this stuff and, you know, et cetera. The first element that I connected to obviously was Earth. I really allowed Earth to speak to me, through me, within me, all these things. And I created a deep, deep, deep relationship with Earth and ground and all that stuff. But soon after, it was air, you know, and there is the story that my friend Chris Lyon in the Stars loves to tell when we went to Joshua Tree in California. And it was very cloudy. And we're talking about gifts, right? The allowance of gifts and allowing yourself to step into gifts. We were going, and I had never done this before. I never even sat with the possibility that I could do it. But I also didn't have the thought that I couldn't. I don't allow that either. And so we were going to Joshua Tree. It's a couple hours to get there. And he was like, man, I'm so bummed out. There are clouds everywhere. I'm not going to see the sky. And I want to see the stars. You know, my name is Lion in the Stars. Like, I want to see the stars. And so we're driving over there, you know. And all of a sudden, I told him, I'm like, I didn't even say anything. I go into like this trance-like meditation state. And I am setting the intention that I can move clouds. And I was like, I'm air. Air is me. Earth is me. Fire is me. Water is me. All composed. Ether is me. And so I was like, what is the limitation here outside of myself? What is, you know, the blockage? What is the stop? The stopping point of limitation? You know, if I wanted to, I can levitate things. If I wanted to, I could move things. I can send telepathic messages. Like, why, you know, is there any limitation in anything? And that's a narrative I have for my life consistently. And so in that space, we're driving. And he's like, I'm so bummed out. We're almost there. Look at these clouds. And so he was going through that. We get to the spot where we're going to do, I was going to do a Shambhala activation over him, right? And I go, I want you to look up into the sky. And I hadn't seen it, right? No, I was like, I want you to look up in the sky. So he looked up and it was a singular circle open, where you can see the stars clearly, like beautiful night. You can see right through them. And yeah. I said, you know what? When we're done with this activation, that circle is going to create a massive radius. So you're going to see the entire night sky. And he was like, what? And I was like, yeah. I'm like, I'm going to make that happen. And we're going to do it together. He was like, okay. So we did the activation. It was powerful. It was beautiful. All of these things that we traveled through and traveled through, you know, it was 20 minutes and we look up and sure enough, it was the whole entire Joshua Tree, open, wide, clear, you know, seeing every single star. And I looked at him. I was like, you're a powerful being. You're a powerful being of divine light and love. What could possibly stand in your way outside of you? Believe in yourself. Believe in your truth and your power and your love and your heart and your soul, you know, and anything, literally anything can happen. And so I started to play with air a lot during that time. I still do. But being able to let air be me. I dance with air.
I can 100% tell you that this is real. Like, I've done this 100%. Yeah, and it was almost funny because then friends would tell me, hey, Jess, can you just move the clouds? I'm like, that's not how it works.
Exactly. Well, you know what? It's happened, though.
Yeah,
we would be with friends in my backyard in my house, and I created a beautiful, beautiful energy in that space, right? Or I awoke a beautiful energy in that space. And my friends would come, and we'd be sitting in the backyard doing what we do, right? And it'd be completely still. And all of a sudden, I'd start doing these hand movements that, again, it's not like I studied them. It's not like I saw them. I just knew that I knew how to do this. I felt it. That's what we were talking about before with the gifts, right? Mm-hmm. And yeah, the wind would pick up and it would come in and it would just whatever. And they were just like, relax. I was like, oh, sorry. But yeah, why not be a child?
Yeah, that's the thing, because a child is so pure, doesn't have any, you know, still pure, clean.
100%.
It's like a clean, how do you say,
slate.
Yeah, and then everything is possible, more and more.
Yeah, in all components of life, right? Yeah. Like that, we're talking about elements, and that's very metaphysical and spiritual and whatever you want to call it, but that's the truth in anything. if you want to call in love, right, a relationship, and I find the collective really gets stuck in this part. You really want to call that sacred partner. I mean, first and foremost, I would do the following. Release the labels. Release it all. Mm-hmm. What you're calling in is just the point of view magnetized in another, right? And it's the heart seeing the heart in the same vibration and alignment that you're in and that you wish to be in. So release the construct, release the label, release the box, the cage, and allow it to flow freely. It magnetizes to you a lot quicker, is what I've found. And so there's no limitation there. Stop creating that there is one. Oh, well, they're hurt and they're wounded and this, and they don't exist. That's a big one. Oh, they don't exist. There's no one like this around. It's like, no, mm-hmm. let it go. Release it. Shed that mm-hmm. already. Throw it out the door. You know, when it comes to finances, the mindset of scarcity is huge in the collective. Well, it's a healing practice. I should only get paid so much and there's not enough money and everyone I magnetize is only, you know, they have this job and da da da. I'm like, well, first and foremost, if there are billionaires in this world, there's money. There's resources. If you are in nature, nature shows you there's resources. If you're breathing, there's resources. If, you know, all this stuff, release. The narratives of limitation, let it go, right? It can all be copy and pasted in every single component of life. And it's funny because the moment that I say that, I hear the people on here right now and the people that are going to listen to this, oh, but you're just saying that, like, whatever, I've heard that, da 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 da. That's your limitation speaking. That's your fear speaking. That's your shame speaking. That's your guilt speaking. That's your trauma speaking, you know? Why wouldn't you be well taken care of if everything in nature is as well? And you are nature. You are the child of Gaia. You are the child of God, of spirit. You are one with this universe. Where is the limitation? Where is the lack? That was for someone. That came in like fire.
Yeah.
You got me preaching.
It's also a sense of belonging is huge, to feel like we belong here, you know, and because sometimes it's easy to get lost in this thing of like, yeah, I'm from this star constellation or what we are here.
Are we going to go there?
I was really gentle with saying that, but I've been there too. And I was like, homesick. I was so homesick to something that I didn't know existed, you know. And then I had to come home here on Earth and realize that, you know, we talk about New Earth and what's wrong, but it's here. You know, New Earth is here. We can build that every day. It's not coming in the near future. Just every single day that we get to spend some time here on Earth, you know. Mm-hmm. So it's here. It's not like somewhere else.
That's what we were saying before, right, Jessica? Nothing in this existence is an external reality. The true reality, the reality of self is within. That's the epicenter of all. That is the creation of your external reality. Mm-hmm. So therefore, your external reality is in constant shift depending on the shift that you are in, the vibration that you choose daily, right? And so in that space, understanding that we are eternal, right? If we are energy, let's even release all that. If we are energy, energy is chaotic. Even this physical vessel that is beautiful and amazing and we get to care for it is a limitation for the energy that we are carrying because it is creating the cage, the box for the energy to be concealed in, contained in, right? But energy as a whole, when we enter into that beautiful state of meditation, of stillness, where the mind dissolves and enters into the heart, where we get into the I am and the being of life, right? We are in everything, every timeline, every expression, and therefore it creates sometimes this bleeding. I'm tapping into Lemuria, I'm tapping into Lyra, I'm in Egypt, I'm in Mesopotamia, I'm in all these spaces. Well, obviously, you have lived all, you have experienced all, and you are ancient by linear thought, but you are all, always, continuously, simultaneously. There is no young old soul. There is a soul. you know, that has lived, that has experienced all, and it's still living all right here in the now, continuously. And that's difficult for the mind, because the mind, the ego, wants to say, label it, put a beginning and an end, put a beginning and an end, put it in a box, label it. No, 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 no. That's from the Starship of Galactic Force 390, and you were there as a commander. I mean, no judgment to that. I understand that space. No, some people are very impassioned by that.
Yeah.
But placing the labels of that I am to one singular truth, you're limiting yourself.
Yeah.
But you're saying to your energy, this is all that you are. And your energy is saying, but I am all. Let go, let go, release, release.
Yeah. And be a channel for whatever wants to come through. I guess.
Nah, it's a beautiful space, Jessica. You created an incredible container, honey.
Thank you for being here, seriously.
Of course.
And also for me, that I get to share also, I feel just really comfortable to share also, like, for my...
I love that. So I love that.
It's a beautiful co-creation. That's what it is.
Yeah. No, I feel into that, honestly. Thank you for creating such a beautiful space and for everyone that joined. These spaces are so fun because you have someone like Jessica that is powerful and magnetic and talented and gifted, you know what I mean? Sort of inviting. You're the anchor of energy in this space. You know what I mean? And so it's beautiful to see what you've cultivated.
Yeah, thank you so much. It's just part of a calling, you know, from both of us and everybody that's here. That's how I see it. You know, it's a manifestation of us all.
I love that.
Amazing. Thank you also, everybody, for being here.
Yes, 100%.
Some people have been from the beginning till now. So that's... awesome, really.
Man, snaps to you guys. Thank you.
That's what I love about the internet as well, really, that it's possible to right now, I just sit in my room having this beautiful conversation with you. You were on the other side of, you know, the ocean.
I'm in Florida.
Yeah, Florida. It's sunny there.
Yes, it's very sunny out here. But it's chilly. Beautiful. It's chilly, but it's very sunny.
Yeah. Oh, amazing. Yeah, it's gray. It's gray. We have to, like, let the sunshine
show you.
Down.
Let me see.
It is not awesome. So it's
let me see if I can show you out this window. I don't know if you can see.
Oh, yeah, beautiful.
It's like, that's the garden.
I don't know much about Florida, but for me, in my, like...
Sarasota.
I only know that it's sunny. That's funny.
Not always. It rains a lot in Florida. Okay. But it's humid, rainy, tropical. That's so cool, Lisa. Sarasota, that's not too far. Yeah, I'm like kind of like near Orlando.
It's in Florida, right? No.
Yes, Sarasota.
Yeah, I send Christopher to Sarasota. Sarasota? Yeah, Sarasota. I send Christopher right there.
Nice.
Yeah, lovely to get to know these hubs. I've called them like hubs.
They are.
Wit, you know.
So yeah.
So I think Sarasota is one of them.
There's a lot of grid points right now being activated, you know, as the collective is shifting into different spaces, different people are being called to different spaces. I think in the next 10, 15 years, we're going to see a lot of movement in that. People are going to be anchoring in some stuff. You know what I mean? In different parts of this beautiful planet. It'll be interesting to sort of witness how that unfolds.
Yeah, really. Yeah, because some of us are called to go to certain places.
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah, amazing. Aww. Thank you for the conversation. I'm going to watch the replay and look at some beautiful snippets. I'm going to share it.
I love that. Yeah, tag me. I'll pop it up.
Thank you, everybody. It's always funny to wrap it up because we're all going our own ways again and into the world, but it was amazing to come together in this space.
It really was. Honestly, thank you for everything, and thank you, guys. This was a beautiful space, my love.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Right, see you. Bye.